On the 25th of May, 2020, police in Minnesota, USA take the life of an unarmed black man. The video of this act goes viral and anti-racism protests break out across the world. Now, more than ever, people are listening. But are we really talking? Well, I guess we can start here with 10 black entrepreneurs sharing their first-hand experiences of racism. We'll kick it off with Donaldson Sake, an ex-professional footballer, now model and fashion entrepreneur. He takes us on a commute in Hamburg in Germany. He was on the tube when this happened.
I was in the tube, was sitting next to a white guy, a white dude. So this white dude was getting aggressive and telling me I should not sit next to him. And starting insulting me that I should go back to my country, I should live in the streets, I should go back to Africa. I didn't want to go into a big discussion or argue with this guy. So I just sat to another place and he was still insulting me, insulting my whole family. I was listening to it. And I said, no, this time I will not reply. I will not say anything to that. So at the next station when I wanted to go out, he was standing up and getting very aggressive. So even I was there with two other friends, which was not understanding the whole situation at that point. He stood up, and when I was getting out of the tube, I saw in the reflection of the mirror that he holds his big suitcase and wanted to hit this suitcase against my head. So luckily, my two friends were there and was pushing him somehow to ground, and the suitcase also fall into the ground, like next to me, like, you know, like this. So I think that situation, I was handling the situation right good. Because I have a few other situations which I was getting very emotional, and it's the black man which will be blamed on all this. Also, the healing is very important. Like, let us be healed from all the pain we experience, right? So, because every time we see another black man get shot, you know, it's something like which hurt us so much, and let's try to heal that.
Up next is Rod Rance, a radio personality, DJ, and entertainment entrepreneur. Rod takes us back, way back, to primary school, here in England, where this happened.
I came to this country around the age of 6, and initially, obviously, English wasn't my first language, it was French. And I was the shortest kid, and I was one of the only black kids in the school. So I was continuously being picked on by four or five white boys. They'd wait for me after school, beat me up, jump me, steal my money, steal my food. I'd complain to the teachers consistently and nothing would get done. They'd get told not to do it again, but of course they'd always do it again. So it got to a point that I had enough. Enough is enough. So I started to fight back. So at first I didn't understand why it was happening. I just knew it was happening. I didn't know it was because of my color of my skin. I just thought they didn't like me for whatever reason. I remember feeling really upset. I remember feeling really down, felt alone. I'd say that that's potentially where a lot of my negative personality traits today, that's potentially the root of them. I remember those days I actually wished a couple of times that I was white. I wished that I was born into a white family. Obviously, I was young, I was upset. I just didn't understand it. Like, obviously, the age I am now, I'm proud to be black. I'm happy I was born in a black family. I'm happy I was born with the family that I'm born with. I'm proud of my roots, do you know what I mean? By the time, I did feel very alone, very isolated. I felt as though being black, which is something that I can't even help, was the worst thing that could have happened to me at the time. So I don't know, I wish at the time I was brave enough to speak then and not speak now. Tried very hard to mentally block a lot of this stuff out of my head so I could live my life without, I suppose, the PTSD of everything.
Next is Anu Seti Amenra. Anu is an entrepreneur and the founder of the Dreamers Cigar Company. He's also ex-military, and in this story, he takes us to a military base in Georgia, USA, where this happened.
Being from Mississippi, it's all too common to have those type of encounters, but one that particularly stood out to me was in Millersville, Georgia. On the day of my commissioning as an officer in the United States Army, I had a senior officer approach me and says, congratulations, you went through the crucible. But honestly, he said, as a black man, I don't believe you have enough life experience that is adequate to serve in this capacity. At the particular time, I believe that I let rage kind of take over me. So I responded in what a way that I would consider not as polished. But during that time, I made it my business to prove him wrong. So I bust my butt, did what I had to do to have a great military career. And that always stuck with me. And every day I tried to make sure that I was the best leader that I could possibly be for my troops, and to make sure when I was allotted the opportunity to see someone else's dreams come to fruition, that I didn't have such negative remarks. And that's my experience. I have a lot more, but that's the particular one that stood out to me when I believed that I had did everything I was supposed to do as a citizen here. But that's life in Black America, man. Stay Black.
And now, Chiroma Banks. Chiroma is an engineer and a fashion entrepreneur. He brings us back to his time working as an engineer in the United Kingdom, where this happened.
A guy I thought was a friend of mine, and over at his birthday, he gets drunk and start throwing all shades of N-words at me. And I never believed I'd get that from someone I considered my friend, white guy. He gets sober next day and starts apologizing, but then, that was an entire experience for me. I've had different forms of N-words. I've had white people on different contracts I've been on, white people, or there was one particular white guy I can remember down in Cumbria that refused to shake my hand. And he particularly said, I think I don't shake hands with your kind, you know. And interestingly enough, I couldn't say this to any of my bosses or report to HR. I just, took it in and just, it's racism. I guess what I could have done differently is being a bit more assertive, being a bit more aggressive with countering whatever racist experience I've had. A lot of people are limited to the understanding that racism is only limited to overt reaction. But there are certain covert things, say systematic, hidden, insidious things about racism, which is white people should adapt cultures that enables them to replace the system of racism with a system of justice. And the system of justice is making sure no one is mistreated and making sure that those that need help the most, particularly black people, get the most constructive help.
Up next, Selector Maestro, an on-air personality, a DJ, and an events entrepreneur. He takes us back to childhood, growing up in London, where this happened.
Where I grew up, it was a very racist environment, you could say. I can tell you all types of experiences. I can tell you the first time someone called me a black monkey, I didn't understand what it meant. And it was only as time passed, I realised that they were taking the mick out of me. So then that started me on a path where I'd have to fight a lot of people. It just became normal. It made me feel, obviously looking back, you could say I was hurt, but the way I dealt with it was, I'm not going to let you get away with calling me that to become a victim. I wouldn't change anything about the way I handled the incident, because I think my stance with racism is zero tolerant. That's a situation where you're standing up for your rights or defending your rights. So to me, in my head, it's justifiable. In these times we're in, it's necessary to keep an open mind and also guard your mind at all costs, because there's so much information going out around now that it's very easy to get caught up in everything, and it can have real serious damage to your mental health. So guard your mind at all costs. Also, always be proud of your blackness, but now more than ever you need to be, and we need to unify more than ever.
Amen Isewi is up next. Amen is a London-born fitness entrepreneur based in Canada. He brings us back to his time in London, walking down the street, minding his own business, heading towards King's Cross St. Pancras Station when this happened.
I'm walking past King's Cross Station and three undercover policemen pick me up, shove me into a van and said I fit the profile of a criminal they were looking for in that neighborhood. I think it was a drug dealer of some sort. And I remember thinking to myself, how could I fit that profile? I'm a student with a backpack, like every other student, to try to get to the train station. But I remember having a really visceral feeling about that. But I didn't walk out of that van an angry black man or angry person, because my parents kind of raised us differently. I'm not saying it's the perfect perspective to have on this, but the way they raised us, the way I saw life at that time, is never dignify anybody that thought you were a lesser person because of your color by even acknowledging them as a person or their own opinion. But as I grew up, I find out it's not enough not to acknowledge them. You have to deal with them. And it's not good enough to be indifferent about it. It's not good enough to be quiet about it anymore. By being silenced about it, you're actually choosing a position to encourage this. So that's the decision. So as I get older, I'm having to educate myself on a different aspect of this. As I teach my white friends, they need to educate themselves on the situation that we're in right now. I have to also educate myself in how to deal with it properly. So there's a lot of education that needs to be done, but being angry is not enough. But we have to stand up and do something about this. It comes from the top down.
And now, Josh Wilson. Josh is the founder of Wilson Worldwide Productions. Josh is based in London, UK, and he takes us through the more insidious elements of racism.
When I was younger, you know, you see a lot of these shows that are being taken down, like Little Britain, things like that, and that's how racism was back then. It was very much laced in comedy. That's what I look at now. If I think back, it was very much laced in comedy. Now, I certainly had, you know, people that a couple of times that rolled up on me in like groups of like 4, 5, 6 or whatever it was, that you know, were abusive or whatever. But what, now, you know, and I was just by myself and I just completely ignored it and walked on, kind of thing. So things like that happened a couple of times. But you know, that was the kind of methodology of people like this. They were petrified. It's, you know, I was brought up by a very strong woman, so you know, I was, you know, you had to be a lion. You had to be, you couldn't let these things, you know, affect you to such a degree where you couldn't cope with some of that. Back then, you know, if someone was overtly racist, it was a big thing. Like if someone would have gone at it, flipping done N-word bashing or stuff like that, like that's a much more serious thing, you know. That didn't happen as much. It still certainly happened, but it didn't happen as much when I was younger. Would I change anything about how I reacted? What can you change? You know what I mean? It's a very awkward situation to be in, isn't it? It's awkward. Do I wish I would have been more outspoken? Yeah, I wasn't. I mean, I've always been an outspoken individual. But yeah, do I wish I would have been more outspoken now? Absolutely. But back then, you know, you're a young man, you're a young adult. So it's not, you have peers and all that stuff, and it's very hard to deal with. You know, racism in that regard, it's the mindset of the weak and the ignorant, you know. And so people that don't understand, the people that don't appreciate this kind of ignorant, you know, arrogant, stupid mentality that we're trying to fix right now, right? Because too many people that are intelligent have been quiet for too long, and we've just let this mindset fester, this weird mindset of racial supremacy, which is kind of a hangover of the past. And because we don't talk, because it's just become such a, it seems so stupid, we don't even feel like we have to talk about it. But we realize we actually do, because these people partly think they're right. You know, we're the only country in the world that's had an anti-racism march. It's absolutely outrageous.
Up next is Prince Shoes. Prince is a social entrepreneur and founder of the Free Your Mind movement. He's now based in London, but takes us to a time growing up in Germany. He's on the bus when this happens.
There was a time where I was sat on a bus, and the bus was packed, and there was a seat right next to me. And no one wanted to sit next to me, you see what I'm trying to say? And it was one of them things where, cool, you don't want to sit next to me, that's not a problem. It might be that you just want to stand, but then I was walking out the bus, yeah, I was coming off the bus, and I think I accidentally barged past a brother, and he done that, You see what I'm saying? Like, oh, why are you touching me type of thing? You see, instantly I was thinking, what do you mean? What do you mean getting aggressive? But back then I was just getting angry and I just wanted to show my pain and just, you know what I mean, fight and show them that, listen, why are you not coming sit next to me and I'm bad, you didn't, what do you think I'm dirty? But it's one of them things that, you know, I've been facing from day. We just have to rise up. Enough is enough.
T. Ali is up next. He's an MC, events host, and runs a model management company. Based in London, UK, he's walking down the street, minding his business, when this happened.
I want to say police brutality, because they didn't beat me up, but I was humiliated. So I remember I was just walking down the street just like this, and there was a Caucasian guy who was just walking right next to me. I don't know him from nowhere. He was going his own way. And then when we got to like the T-junction, he went left, I went right. And then the police followed me, saying that they searched me and everything. And I said, why am I being stopped and why am I being searched? And they said, they're searching me because of suspicion of drug selling. Like they thought I was selling drugs or had sold drugs to that guy. And, you know, it was in front of my university halls where the rest of the students were. And, like, some of them were recording. And, you know, my pants fell down because they opened up my belt. And then, you know, we used to wear baggy jeans then. My pants fell to the ground. And I was like, you guys are stripping me naked in the middle of the street. And he literally said to me to shut the F up. And I was like, this is not the way to treat a human being. And they were like, you ain't a human being. And I was like, I'm going to make a report. I was like, make a report then. Listen, bro, I was just so angry. And so, you know, these things are happening to everyone and everywhere, but this generation is not going to have it, and we're going to put an end to it.
Ishmael Oshodi is up next. He's a serial entrepreneur, the founder of Oshodi Foods and Food Junkie Van. He's driving around in London, UK, when this happened.
From sly comments to being chased in a car to fighting, various types, you know. Experience was mad. There was one experience where the guy said, it was basically a little traffic madness. The guy must have muttered something, didn't think I heard him. Yeah, and yeah, he got a bit chasey. And yeah, ended it how it was supposed to end, you know what I'm saying? People, we have to learn lessons and teach each other lessons, you know. I guess that was his day to learn a lesson, but yeah. And that's the problem. We always feel like we should feel a way. We shouldn't say certain things. We shouldn't do certain things. Two wrongs don't make a right, but how do you figure out which wrong is right? The world's a crazy place, you know, and we have to be very careful how we think the world is for us and how the world actually is, you know. Keep pushing your culture, keep pushing your native tongue, keep pushing the next generation. Yeah, we'll take it further than it's ever been, you know, always.
Some of this content might shock you. You might begin to question everything you've learned in life so far. To some, it'd be no surprise at all. But at least you're listening, and for that, I thank you. I wasn't going to let this end without sharing one of my experiences of racism. I am Clef Vic, creative entrepreneur and founder of The Sam Company, based in Surrey, UK. My experience goes back to when I worked a 9-to-5. I'm in the office, and this happens. A colleague of mine walked up to me and said, and we had a conversation, and I said something like, oh, I need to see that in black and white, meaning send me an email or type it out and print it. And he goes, oh, you know, you can't say that anymore in this country, political correctness. Back in the day, I used to work with these Nigerians. So he went off on a tangent. So when he said, you can't say that anymore, political correctness, my heart sank, because I knew this guy was going somewhere else with this. And then he said, back in the 80s, I used to work with these Nigerian bouncers, and they used to say, and this is how he said, they used to say N-word. So he said N-word like 5 times to me, and not like the way I'm saying it. He actually said N-I-G-G, you can feel the rest. I was shocked at first. And then as I processed it, because I think I went to the toilet, as I kept processing it, it went from anger to sadness. Because thinking of it, I could have gone straight to HR, I could have gone to a manager, or I could have done something about it, but I didn't. You know, and I guess I have to live with that guilt. It was premeditated, there was no doubt, and it was planned out. I probably should have just pulled him aside and said, let's have a word, and then taking him away from the office and had stern words with him, looking him in the eyes and saying, you don't do that kind of thing. That would have been ideal, but that didn't happen. I just replied to him and said, sorry, mate, this is not a conversation I'd like to have with you.